yet to hear from any member of Congress who says they've been called by Russia with information and never turned it over to the FBI.
All right, this comes as Donald Trump Jr., who organized that infamous June 2016 Trump Tower meeting with the Russians, returned to Capitol Hill for more testimony. And Hope Hicks, the former White House communications director and longtime Trump aide, will testify next week before a House panel investigating President Trump. But none of that is the huge headline this morning. Joining us now to talk about the huge headline is White House correspondent for New York Times and CNN political analyst Maggie Haberman. So, Maggie, the president didn't seem to enjoy the past 3 years of investigations from Robert Mueller, and yet he is willing to do it all over again. He has learned nothing.
His whole statement is no collusion, no obstruction of justice. So apparently it's no collusion, but it would have been okay if we did. This message, the whole thing they had been saying about the Trump Tower meeting, about every other attempted contact by Russians with the campaign during 2016 was, we didn't know, we were political neophytes, we didn't know how this was supposed to go, now we know. You have the president now saying, yeah, so what? What's the big deal? You had his son-in-law in an interview with Axios say a similar thing, which was, you know, when he was asked by Jonathan Swan, would you let the FBI know this time around about that Trump Tower meeting? It was, you know, I don't know, I'm not going to engage in a high. So, no, it doesn't seem like a whole lot of lessons have been learned. And to be clear, this is no longer just about Russia. This is about any foreign
country.
That's
how George Stephanopoulos posed the question. Anything. Right. So, Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, Iran. I mean, step right up.
Israel, there are a ton of countries that could be offering assistance. And the president is just flat out wrong when he calls this opposition research. Opposition research is something that, as you know very well, that campaigns work on, which is basically about public records. It is about things that are in the public domain that are available. It is not things that are stolen from a campaign or stolen from somebody's files. That is what he's talking about, and he's trying to make it all sound as if it's all the same. It is not all the same.
Foreign countries don't do opposition research.
Yeah,
they do intelligence.
Correct.
Right? I mean, they do spying. Right. It's a different thing.
Right, and there are different types of things. One is sort of intel collection, which most countries do, and then there are things like trying to get people to click on malware, which is what we were talking about during the 2016 campaign, and where that information came from. And this is another thing where people around the president will say, well, news organizations use this material, or it was on WikiLeaks. You know, the law is about elected officials. Mm-hmm. That is what we're talking about here.
And it's explicit, by the way.
It is explicit.
Can we just clear up a few things here? The president says he's never called the FBI in his life.
That's not true. I mean, he in either the late 70s or 80s, when he was a casino developer, and he realized that there could be some problems with some of the people he was associating with in building these casinos who had alleged mob ties, he called the FBI, said that he wanted to fully cooperate, quote unquote. This is in an FBI file. This isn't just made up. This was written about during the campaign. It was written about in 2017. It was written about by the late Wayne Barrett, who wrote phenomenal stuff about Donald Trump's time long before the presidency. So that is also not true.
So when it helps him, he called the FBI.
Right. When it was in his self-interest, he called the FBI, and he described himself as wanting to be extremely helpful. Right now, he's in his self-interest. It might be better to take assistance from a foreign power.
So has there ever been a more Machiavellian statement uttered? I mean, the idea that whatever it takes to win. So whatever what everybody has endured for the past 3 years, what Democrats, what Congress, what voters, what the White House, with this investigation, we should prepare for, as the president gears up for this next campaign, to be in the same situation.
One other statement that he made that I was very struck by, and you just mentioned Congress, members of Congress, you know, he said, if you go ask members of Congress, they all do this too. Not true, number one. But you haven't heard any member of Congress say, yes, I do this. You also haven't heard any Republican member of Congress say, this is really wrong. What he said is not true. And so once again, you are seeing Republicans moving in lockstep with what the president says, despite the fact that they know, all of those members of Congress know, that foreign interference is a whole different order of magnitude. And he is trying to make it all sound the same. He's really sort of throwing under the bus Republican members of Congress who have gone out on a limb for him and said, these investigations were unfair. How can you accuse him of this? Of course, nothing bad would have happened. And once again, he takes a statement and just makes it harder for his defenders.
I think some will find a way to half condemn this.
I think that's probably true.
I think when we get some of these members, if they ever agree to come on and ask them directly, they can't say yes, we would take it, because there's not a single elected official I've ever met in my life, besides the president, who says that they would take foreign information in an election.
No, and there was such a striking statement that he made to Stephanopoulos, which was, give me a break. That's not how life works, or that's not how real life works. Life doesn't work that way. That has been his whole mantra: is this is how we do things in sort of the real world, and you people with your elections are different. When you are the president of the United States, you are the commander in chief. You are supposed to set the tone. That is a role that he has eschewed time and time again, and he did again in this interview.
How do the people around him in the White House, who've also endured all of this for the past few years, how are they responding this morning?
There is a bunker mentality for almost everybody working in that White House, which I think you know. He turns everything into an up-down referendum on himself, and they sort of join on that, where the people who are criticizing him, they see as wrong, they see him as right. There were some people who were present for that interview and who were aware that this was going to be problematic, but as I understand it, I don't think anybody did anything to try to either cut the interview off or try to change the topic, or it just sort of rolls along. It's his show.
I will tell you, the optics of it in the Oval Office, to have that happen in the Oval Office, I have to believe, we had Josh Campbell on before, people who've worked in intelligence in the FBI saying this is something that will have been discussed over the last 24 hours in foreign intelligence services around.
Of course it would be. And I mean, and him also saying that the FBI director is wrong for saying that kind of a meeting or a contact is something that they would want. He is once again publicly undercutting the head of the FBI to take sides with, essentially just the possibility of foreign help. Somebody said on Twitter, and I thought it was a good point, that it might be more stunning if the president actually did condemn this and say, of course not. That's probably true, because I don't think it's a huge surprise. I think we have seen that he generally views the principle of self-help first
and winning at any cost.
At any cost, correct, whatever it takes. That said, he is still the president, and it was still a really stunning statement.
You know, he hasn't had a director of communications, I guess, for a while.
Bill Shine.
Yeah.
And he wasn't the director of communications.
Yes, so whatever right. role that was.
Right.
But it has been pointed out, I think by Laura Ingraham, that the optics also are strange of George Stephanopoulos standing over the Resolute desk, mm-hmm. taller than the president. The president...
That's the part that Ingraham took issue with?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, actually.
Wasn't it also just that she agreed to talk, that he agreed to talk to ABC?
Oh, yes.
He got questions
also,
different than how blue are your very blue
what
eyes?
They would be appalled by. But my point is that there were strange things about that. I mean, not just... he said something so appalling, but that the optics and in the Oval Office. And so would a director of communications have been able to stop any of that?
Probably not at this point, honestly, because, again, I think that the president is setting the tone for so much of this. But I think that at a certain point, we saw this. It's funny you mentioned Ingraham. Ingraham was the one who did that interview with the president at Normandy, where you had the backdrop of gravestones as he was attacking Robert Mueller, and he was responding to leaked criticism from Nancy Pelosi. Most presidents would have avoided doing that, but most presidents, he obviously isn't aware of the settings he's in, and that's where you rely on staff to sort of help out, and the staff almost never does in these cases. So this is another example.
The New York Times overnight, some of your colleagues also have a story on exactly what the William Barr investigation mm-hmm. is going to be looking into and who they will be speaking with, mm-hmm. and it includes some officials in the CIA mm-hmm. who apparently were connected with the assessment that Russia was trying to help Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. When?
Mm-hmm.
Curious.
It is curious. Look, I think that Barr has made clear that he was going to take investigating the investigators seriously, and I think that this is another example of it. I think the question is going to become how deep that look goes, what it looks at in terms of sources and methods. I'm loath to say too much about it without knowing what it's going to look like going forward, but it is another unusual step that we are seeing from an investigator close to President Trump.
Don Jr., the president's son, also went back and sort of retestified mm-hmm. behind closed doors because they had found discrepancies between what he had claimed and what Michael Cohen mm-hmm. had claimed. We don't